Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the second day of the third annual Goa Arts and Literary Festival. A very small festival started in a very small way by a group of writers who had a lot of passion and thought this would be a great location and a great place to have this kind of an event, and it has grown and become more significant, and today really I think is its greatest day yet. For that, I'd first like to start by thanking the governor, really. Mr. Vanchu, thank you so much for this. This is an extraordinary privilege to be here. You've opened this historic structure which speaks of our culture and civilization to the product of its culture, which is its art and its literature. And today we're going to see some of the very best that we have to offer and from around the world. This evening's ceremonies will be led by a member of Goa Writers Group. Goa Writers Group is an all-volunteer group, but it's very vibrant, and it has created all kinds of surprising real-life developments. But in the Goa Writers Group, we are extraordinarily privileged because we have two wonderful mentors. One of them is Sri Damodar Mauso, who you all know and you've met yesterday. None of this would ever have been possible without Mr. Mauso. But in fact, the Goa Writers Group itself would not have been possible without Mr. Victor Rangel Ribeiro, who in his 70s became a widely acclaimed and decorated novelist. And Mr. Victor Rangel Ribeiro then seeded and helped, he lives in New York most of the year, but he formed this little group of writers and poets, and in an eccentric way we started to get together, then because of him in a less eccentric way. And today, Victor, I think you've really reached someplace. So thank you very much. Please look after the evening. I'm going to invite the readers, yes, please, a big hand of applause for Mr. Victor Rangel Ribeiro. Today we are going to have a wonderful slate of readings followed by the Ban Pathars. 6 months ago, I'll just take a minute to tell you, 6 months ago I saw the Ban Pathars on a hillside in Srinagar, and they were extraordinary. Most people in Kashmir never get to see this group. The reaction from the Kashmiris from across, from the kind of people who came in there with security guards, to the security guards, to the driver who drove in the security guards, was extraordinary. It was overwhelming. You're going to experience something really remarkable here today. And Mr. M.K. Raina will introduce them. But we have a wonderful slate of readings. First of all, we have from Portugal, Mr. Landeg White, who has rewritten. Please join us on stage, Landeg. Mr. Landeg White has recast Camões, the great bard of Portugal, as the way he should have been all along, as the great bard of Goa. So, Mr. Landeg White, please join us. Mr. Pundalik Naik, the great Konkani literator, will be reading today. Thank you, sir, for joining us. Today we have the privilege of hearing from the next book from our Padma Shri Award winner, Aurora Couto. She's going to be doing an exclusive reading. Please join us, Auntie Aurora. Representing the locals in a very profound way is Mr. Manohar Shetty, who lives just a kilometer down the road and is releasing his latest book of poetry. Manohar Shetty, people probably don't know, but Dona Paula is home to one of the great English language poets, modernist poets of our era. Manohar, please join us on stage. He's going to be releasing his newest book, Body Language. Two other really special guests today. As the Goa Writers Group, our guests are not chosen by publishing companies. They're not chosen by the exigencies of booksellers. They're chosen because we really respect these writers. They're the best. They're people who we really care about. Today, we're very, very privileged to have Ms. Mamang Dai with us, joining us from Arunachal Pradesh. She is one of India's great writers, poets, novelists, and representing the margins of this great country from the very opposite side, Ms. Mamang Dai. Please join us. And finally, a big round of applause to this year's Booker Prize nominee, Mr. Jeet, Thayil, who is joining us. Jeet is a award-winning poet. He's written music. He's a rock and roller. His new novel, which was nominated for the Booker Prize, central characters based on our own Francis Newton Souza, who he knew in New York. Jeet, please join us. Thank you. Victor, all yours.
Thank you. It is easier for me to see you from here and from you to see me too. So we are going to get the proceedings started right away. Landeg, I think you go first. This is not a very good day for me, and I'll explain why. Last year, I thought that I would begin translating the poetry of Camoens. He has done that already. He won an award for it. And now I'm anxious to hear. Yes. You, me?
Yes, I will have done.
Yes. Will you please?
That wasn't me. This is a festival, so I'm going to start with a very light-hearted poem that was very popular in Goa in the 1550s. It's called Por Coisa So Tapoco. Am I too close? Pocoisa Tapoco. Over something so trite, you're completely enamored. You love the headgear, not see who tied it. I'm blind and distracted over you, dumb John, and you over a turban. You're in love with some fabric. You might as well be a slave. Don't you know true love displays herself naked? But you're distracted over a thing like a turban, and I over you, dumb John. Whoever loves as I do deserves to be loved, not wander aggrieved through loving you. Love what's true. I forget your turban. That's good advice, dumb John. Everyone's flabbergasted by your stupidity. On account of your idiocy, Gonzalo's aghast and goes singing this skit. Look, our turbans captivated dumb John. Did you ever notice my own hairdo? Adorable too, if that's your bias. Don't be lugubrious. Love me, dumb John, and not some turban. Why, I don't know, you love a wardrobe when the self-same Cupid wears not even a bow. Do you know why you so fancy a turban? It's because you're dumb, John. No. That's the poet Luis de Camoens, in lighter mood, very far from his epic manner. It's a very great honor and privilege for me to participate in this Goan Arts and Literature Festival, and also a privilege to be first speaker at this session in this wonderful setting. But I've also come here with something of a mission. I've spent 7.5 years translating Camoens' poetry, first for Lucians, and then more recently his vast body of lyrical poetry. And I want to tell you something about Camoens that the Portuguese never told you. He was born in Lisbon in 1524, grew up as a son of a minor noble on the outer fringes of the aristocracy, grew up educated we don't know where. In his early youth, he was on the fringes of the court, trying to get access to a courtly appointment by writing accomplished but very conventional verse in the Petrarchan and pastoral manner. But he had also got himself frequently into great trouble. First, for an offence we don't know, he was exiled by the king to serve as a soldier in North Africa and spent 1 or 2 years there. Back in Lisbon in 1550, he got into trouble once again in a brawl with a court official and was sentenced this time to serve as a common soldier, a degradado, here in Goa. He sailed for Goa in 1553, arriving in November, and stayed here for 15 years. It was here he spent the best part of his adult life. Here he wrote the bulk of all his best poems, and that is something that can be demonstrated by a close reading of the lyrics. And I think it's high time you reclaimed him as a Goan poet. Now, what do I mean by this? His problem was that his early life had been focused on getting access to the court. that ambition fails him completely because of his personal behaviour. When he's sent here, he comes, as I say, as a degradado, as a common soldier. On his way, and shortly after his first arrival, he is still playing at writing courtly verses, talking about marching into battle, proclaiming his loved one's name, or wearing her favours on his shield. But it's very quickly obvious that there is an enormous gap between his poetic language and his actual circumstances. His circumstances are pretty dreadful. He has to give up the idea of being a court poet, but that faces him with a problem. Why is he to write if he's not writing for favours at court? What is the point of writing poetry if you have no audience? He has to rethink the very basis of his art, and it's the process of doing that here in Goa that changes him from being, as I say, an accomplished but conventional Renaissance poet to one of the greatest poets of the period. Now let me read you some examples to try to persuade you. This is a sonnet. Invent fresh arts and cunning, love, to destroy me, and new frustrations. But you can't remove my expectations by taking away what I don't have. Look where my hopes are grounded. Observe what perilous guarantees that I don't fear on the wildest seas, contrast or change, the ship having foundered. But insofar as I'm not unhappy when hope fails, love maintains within an evil that destroys, and in secret. Some days their pitches camp in me, I know not what, nor where it is born, nor whence it comes, nor why it hurts. Now that is a poem that is at the farthest reach from being a courtly poem. It is utterly personal, utterly simple, dismayingly simple for the translator. My version is more elaborate than the original, almost unavoidably in English. He's invented a new type of love poem here in Goa, one that is different from the kinds of love poetry that were in favour at the time, which depicted the mistress on a pedestal with the poet approaching on his knees and worshipping from afar and expecting to be repulsed. This is a different kind of love poetry, intense, personal, simple, the sort of thing that Shakespeare was to do, but 50 years later. And he goes further. This is a poem called Indacia Sababra Strava, an amazing poem, a love poem, that begins, "That slave I own." Can you imagine any modern poet beginning with a line like that? "That slave I own." It would be completely unthinkable. What he does is describes a woman who is a captive in Goa, and who, like captives at the time, were made slaves of the conquerors. He has made her her concubine. Apparently she's reluctant to be part of this, but it's happened. And out of this situation of gross colonial sexual exploitation, he conjures a poem using the very reversal of the Petrarchan modes, but which nevertheless persuades her that these people had, at least from his point of view, a real relationship. It's an amazing poem. "That slave I own, who holds me captive, living for her alone, who scorns I should live. No hybrid rose drenched in dew was ever to these eyes half so lovely. The flowers in the field and the stars above in their beauty yield to my love. Distinct in feature, eyes dark and at rest, tired creature, but not of conquest. Here dwells the sweetness by which I live, she being mistress of whom she is captive. Her hair is raven, and the fashion responds, forgetting its given preference for blonde. Love, being negro, at so sweet a figure, the blanketing snow vows to change colour. Gladly obedient and naturally clever, this may be expedient, but barbarous, never. Quiet presence, that silences storms, all my disturbance finds peace in her arms. This is the vassal that makes me her slave, being the muscle that keeps me alive." A And of course, the greatest accomplishment of his years in Goa was the epic poem, The Lusians, of which I would find it easier to talk for a whole hour than talk for just 2 minutes. For those of you who don't know it, it's an epic poem built around Vasco da Gama's pioneer voyage to India in 1498. And it's a poem that contains many voices, African, Indian, Chinese, Muslim, Hindu, Christian. One of those voices is undeniably triumphalist Portuguese, but it's counterbalanced by other voices, and that is a passage containing one of these other voices that I want to read to you. The speaker is in the passage is Vasco da Gama telling the Sultan of Malindi the history of Portugal and how he came to be making his present voyage. And in the course of what his explanation, he describes the departure of the fleet from Lisbon in 1497, and something that happened at that point of departure when an old man stood up and denounced the whole enterprise. He's known in Portuguese as the Velho de Restelo, the old man from Restelo. There's a pleasing irony in that nowadays the Indian consulate in Portugal is located in Restelo, so you have to go there to get a visa to come to India. That day, a vast throng from the city, as friends, as family, others only to watch, crowded the shore, their faces anxious and dismayed, looking on as in the holy company of 1,000 zealous monks, with heartfelt intercessions on our lips, we marched in solemn file towards the ships. The people considered us already lost on so long and uncertain a journey, their women with piteous wailing, the men with agonizing sighs. Mothers, sweethearts, and sisters, made fretful by their love, heightened the desolation and the arctic fear we should not return for many a long year. One such was saying, "Oh, my dear son, my only comfort and sweet support in this my tottering old age, now doomed to end in grief and pain, why do you leave me wretched and indigent? Why do you travel so far away to be lost at sea as your memorial and bloated fish your only burial? Or one bareheaded. O dearest husband, but for whose love I could not exist, why do you risk on the angry seas that which belongs to me, not you? Why, for so dubious a voyage, do you forget our so sweet affection? Is our passion, our happiness, so frail as to scatter in the wind swelling the sail?" As these piteous, loving speeches poured from gentle human hearts, the old and the children took them up in the different manner of their years. The nearest mountains echoed them as if stirred by deepest sympathy, while tears as many as the grains of sand rained without ceasing on the white strand. As for us, we dared not lift our faces to our mothers or our wives, fearing to be harrowed or discouraged from the enterprise so firmly begun. And I decided we should all embark without the customary farewells, for though they may be love's proper course, they make the pain of separation worse. But an old man of venerable appearance, standing among the crowd on the shore, fixed his eyes on us disapproving and wagged his head 3 times. Then raising a little his infirm voice, so we heard him clearly from the sea, with a wisdom only experience could impart, he uttered these words from a much tried heart. "O pride of power, O futile lust for that vanity known as fame, that hollow conceit which puffs itself up and which popular cant calls honor. What punishments, what poetic justice you enact on souls to pursue you, to what deaths, what miseries you condemn your heroes, what pains you inflict on them. You wreck all peace of soul and body. You promote separation and adultery. Subtly, manifestly, you consume the wealth of kingdoms and empires. They call distinction, they call honor what deserves ridicule and contempt. They talk of glory and eternal fame, and men are driven frantic by a name. To what new catastrophes do you plan to drag this kingdom and these people? What perils, what deaths have you in store under what magniloquent titles? What visions of kingdoms and gold mines will you guide them to infallibly? What fame do you promise them? What glories? What conquests and story and processions? What stories? As for you, heirs of that madcap Adam, whose sin and disobedience not only drove us from paradise into this exile and sad absence, but deprived us forever of the divine state of simple tranquility, that golden age of innocence before this age of iron experience and war. Already in this vainglorious business, delusions are possessing you. Already ferocity and brute force are labeled strength and valor. The heresy, long live death, is already current among you, when life should always be cherished, as Christ in times gone by, who gave us life, was yet afraid to die. Is not the Ishmaelite close at hand, with whom you have waged countless wars? If a fresh crusade is your purpose, does he not bow to the face of Arabia? If it is land and riches you desire, does he not own 1,000 cities? Or if it's fresh battle honors you covet, is he not still a formidable target? You ignore the enemy at the gate in the search for another so far away, unpeopling the ancient kingdom, leaving it vulnerable and bereft. You are lured by the dangers of the unknown, so history will flatter you as signors, or titles yet more copious, Indias, Persias, Arabias, Ethiopias. The devil take the man who first put dry wood on the waves with a sail. Hell's fires are too good for him if the laws I live by are righteous. And may no solemn chronicler, no sweet harpist or eloquent poet commend your deeds or celebrate your fame, but let your folly vanish with your name. Prometheus stole the fire from heaven which rages in every human heart, setting the world ablaze with arms, with death and dishonor, and all for nothing. How much better for you, Aras Prometheus, how much less harmful for the world, had you not breathed into your famous statue the restlessness that goads mankind to match you? Unhappy Phison would not have crashed Apollo's car, nor craftsman Daedalus dropped from the sky with his son, naming the latter a sea, the former a river. In what great or infamous undertaking, through fire, sword, water, heat, or cold, was man's ambition not the driving feature? Wretched circumstance, outlandish creature. As the honorable old man was uttering these words, we spread our wings to the serene and tranquil breezes and departed from the loved shore. And as is now the custom at sea, the sails unfurled, we bellowed, Godspeed, and the north winds, as usual, heard and responded, shifting the great hull. The sun was in Leo, the ferocious beast of Nemea slain by Hercules, and the world was in the sixth age of its decline since Christ's birth, having witnessed, as custom has it, 1,400 journeys of the sun plus 97, the last still in motion, when our small armada turned to face the ocean. Little by little, our gaze was exiled from the native hills we left behind. There remained the dear Tagus and green Sintra, and on those our sight long dwelt. Our hearts, too, remained behind us, lodged with their griefs in the loved land. And when at last all faded from the eye, nothing was visible but sea and sky. I just want to remind you, those words were properly written here. Thank you.
Landeg, thank you. What we heard today was a very extraordinary reading, I think. It was not a translation in my eyes, but it was a recreation of poetry. And that is not to be wondered at, because the reader and translator is himself a poet. May we give him some applause again, please. Thank you. Our second reader today will be Pundalik Naik, And before I ask Kiran Budkuley to introduce him here, I want to say a few things about him myself. I came to know him first as a novelist through the translation of his novel Achev, The Upheaval. Damodar Mauso told me that Pundalik is a wonderful playwright, and many other people told me the same thing. A third, yet another person said, Pundalik is a poet. So to clear up this confusion, I went and I asked him today, Pundalik, who are you really? And he said he began as a poet, he became a novelist, and now he writes plays. And the plays give him very great satisfaction because he can reach out to people, he can change minds, and as the plays being performed, he can see the reaction of the audience. Pundalik Naik and Kiran Budkuley, please come up. Where, oh, there you are.
Good evening, everybody. Sagalyank bari sanja avdeta. Please, Kiran.
Good evening, His Excellency, the Governor of Goa, Lady Governor, organizers of this beautiful evening event, various authors and readers on stage with me, and friends. It is indeed a moment of reckoning for many of us. I see this as a reflection of the confluence behind, the confluence of the river and the sea, and here it is of poetry with transcreation, and what with introduction of writers by themselves and others. Introducing Pundalik Naik in Goa, to me, is a kind of failed effort because everybody knows him only too well. Yet, I think, in view of few of our esteemed guests, it is necessary once again to retrieve the Pundalik that is hidden in our hearts. Pundalik Naik is a multifarious personality, an author, poet, a playwright par excellence, a short story writer who has set certain standards in Konkani short story. He is also an editor, and I should not be counting his works. Only his plays are around 55. It was indeed difficult to select some presentation for today, and we suggested, why don't you take a short take on Marn Kato. Marn Kato literally means the embankment of death. But in the play, it is as fascinating as the embankment behind me. And I think this translucent evening descending into the dark, with the waters beckoning us with their sounds and no visibility. Such is the setting of Marn Kato. In the play, there is this young protagonist who could rub shoulders with the protagonists of Waiting for Godot. Just like them, distraught, disheveled, and totally disillusioned with life. So much so he believes even his mother has let him down by giving him birth into this world. And then, as a stray ray of hope comes an advertisement where somebody is going to guide his life. And that meeting with the purveyor is set on the embankment of death. You shall presently have Pundalik Naik in chaste Konkani present a part of this play, and at the end, in a couple of minutes, I will try and sum its essence, if possible, in my words. Pundalik Naik for you.
How I love you, buzzers. हमें तुझे पेपरातली जाहिरात वाचली सगळेच वाचतं माका दिसलें तुम्ही माका वाट दाखयत अवश्य म्हजो धंदोच तो धंदो हय आयच्या काळात धंद्याच्यो मर्यादा खूब विस्तारल्यात गरजे प्रमाण नवे नवे धंदे तयार जातात हांव चिणीत खूब निरशेलां तुझी पिराय घेतली 25 वर्षं. तुझी तोखणाय करूंक जाय. कित्याक ह्या संवसारांत 20 वर्सां भितरच मनीस निर्शेतात. 25 वर्सां म्हळ्यार तुवें बरोच तग मारलो. खरेंच म्हाका तशेंच दिसता. हांव आजून मेरेन कसो जितो आसा ताजेंच अजाप दिसता. ताजो उपाय म्हजे लागीं आसा. तेजेच खातीर तर हांव इतली वाट माड्डून आयलां. तुजी फावट फुकट वचची ना. हय, एके फावटीन जातलें काय परत येवचो पडटलो? परत परत फावटी मारूंक लागपाचे धंदे दोतोर आदोगादांचे हांगासर पयलीच फावट, तीच निमाणी फावट. तूं खापो धन्वंतरी दिसता. प्रभूची लिला. फी आसतली न्ही? दरेकल्याक पोट आसता. हय, ह्या पोटानूच हो मार्ग म्हाका दाखयलो ना. पोट मार्ग दाखयना, पोट निर्माण करता प्रश्न. हय, ह्या पोटानूच जगचें काय मरचो हो प्रश्न निर्माण केलो. बेकार, सामको बेकार. दुख्ख विसरपाक सिगरेटचे पोतेर उडटलो जाल्यार दमडी ना. पूण तुगेली फीची वेवस्था केल्या हांवें, तर कितले जातले? सवकास साहेब, धंदो जरी आसलो तरी पयसो होच म्हजो उद्देश न्ही. पिडेस्तांचें समाधान हीच म्हजी खरी जोड. आयच्या काळांत ही गजाल मेळपाक खूब कुस्तार. वचत थंय फटींगपणां. तूं चड फटवलो, चिणें सामको नागवलो. सगळे धोंगी दिसता एक एकल्याचेर उपरे टरार चर पिंजून उडोवचे. मागीर खंय हाडटा? हात मोटवे पडटा. हात लांब करूंक मेळनात? हात लांब करूंक मेळटा खोमसाचे. तूं खऱ्यांनीच म्हजे कडेन येवपाक योग्य आसलो. तुका कोणे कोणे फटयलो? कोणा कोणाची म्हूण नांवां घेवं? पयली सुवात ह्या संवसारांत जल्मांक घालून म्हाका आवयन फटयलो. खरेंच ह्या संवसारांत तुका जल्मांक घालपाचोच न्ही. आतां एकूच भरवंसो आसा तुजे कडेन. तूं म्हाका फटोवचो ना हाजी म्हाका खात्री आसा. तुजी खात्री पटली हेंच म्हज्या धंद्याचें वडपण. तुजे खातीर हांवें दुसऱ्या संवसाराची तजवीज केल्या. फी आदी दिवपाची, अर्थात आदी, पूण इतली ताकतीक नाका. इतली स्पश्टपणां लेगीत ह्या संवसारांत पळोवपाक मेळना. तुजे खातीर ह्या दुश्ट संवसाराची दारां सासणां खातीर बंद करुया. ह्या पाडंग संवसारांत म्हजे खातीर कोणेंच दार काडलें ना. शिक्षणाची दारां तुजे खातीर बंद आसली. ती उक्ती आसून फायदो कितें? संडासाच्या दारांचो उपेग जाता तितलो लेगीत जिणेंत शिक्षणाच्या दारांचो जालो ना. बरोच दुखावला. दुखा बगर दुसरें कितें आसा ह्या संवसारांत? मागीर सूख म्हणटा तें खंय आसता? तेंच तुका विचारपाक आयलां. बरें पयशे सासना खातीर त्या सुखाचें दार हांव उक्तें करून दी. म्हाका उमळशीक लागल्या. तुका मातसो थार धरचो पडटलो. चड तेंप ना. जाय जाल्यार चड फी दिवपाक हांव तयार आसा, ताजी गरज ना. सगळ्याक अशेंच चलता जाणा हांव, पूण हांगा तशें चलना. हे जिणेचें निमाणें तोंक. निमाणें तोंक? हय, सामकें निमाणें. हांगा सगळ्या दुख्खांचो अंत जाता आनी सुखाची पालय दिसता. न्ही तुजो पुनर्जन्माचेर विश्वास आसा? ना. मागीर हांगा दुख्खाचो अंत जाता हेंच निमाणें सत्य. हां, तुज्या काळजांतली ती आशेची निमाणी कीट पालोवन उडय. ते किटी वांगडा तुजें दुख्खय वाडीक लागतले. तूं कितें सोसूंक सोदता? तुज्या भल्याचें हांवें कितें करप? म्हजो कटो तुजे खातीर सज्ज आसा. कटो? हय, मरण कटो. हां, कसली जिवनाची आसक्तीन इतलो कांचवेलो? हे न्हंय धडेर हो कटो कित्या खातीर बांदला? दुख्खी जिणेंतल्यान मुक्ती जोडपाक, जीव दिवपाक. हय, जीव दिवपाक. तुज्या धंद्याचें स्वरूप कितें? खंयच्याय धंद्या परस म्हजो धंदो उक्तो. आनी हेर धंद्यांतली फटींगपणां तातूंत ना. ह्या कट्यावयल्यान जीव दिवप. हय, पूण ताचे आदी म्हजी फी फारीक करप. दुडू फारीक करून जीव दिवपाक एक तर पिशें लागूंक जाय. हय, मनशाक मरणाचें लेगीत पिशेंच लागता. तूंय ताका आडवाद ना. हांव हांगा जीव दिवपाक येवना. हांगा आयिल्लो दर एकलो अशेंच सांगतालो. आनी मागीर आपखोशेन ह्या कट्यावयल्यान जीव दितालो. जीव दिवपाचो जाल्यार कितले उपाय आसात? वीक खावं येता, बायक घालूं येता, रेल्वेच्या रुळाचेर मान दिवं येता. पूण तातूंत धोको आसा. तुवें वीक समजा तुवें वीक खाल्लें जाल्यार पयल्याच धपक्याक तूं सोंपतलो म्हूण कितें भरोसो आसा? आयच्या काळांत विखांत लेगीत भेसळ आसता. बायत घालून सोंपें, पूण तेच प्रमाणा बायतल्या मनशाक वाटोवपूय सोंपें. अशा वेळार बुडटल्याक वाचोवपाचो लोकांक मोठो की वांटो येता. आनी रेल्वेच्या रुळार मान दिवप म्हणटा तें एक फकाण. ह्या देशांतल्यो ट्रेनी अमुकूच वेळार येतलो म्हणपाचो कितें भरवंसो आसा? ह्या सगळ्या उपायांत रिस्क आसा. हांगा तशें ना. ह्या मरण कट्यावयल्यान एकदां उडी मारली, खलास. मरण हो एक पवित्र खीण, तो खीण जोडतना कुणीक वेदना भोगप योग्य न्हय. मरण कटावेले मरण खरेंच भाग्याचे, म्हण चडशे मरणकार हांगाच येतात. आनी तातूंत उडी मारतकच उदकाक तेंकचे आदीं तुजो जीव गेलो जाल्यार तुजे सारको भाग्यवान तूंच. मागीर मेल्या उपरांत कितें, मेल्या उपरांत कितें, ह्या प्रश्नाक मरतल्याचे नदरेन कसलें म्हत्व आसा, मड्याचें कितें, तें जिते आशिल्ले मनीस पळोवन घेतात. तूं भिव नाका, मरण कट्यावेल्यान जीव दिल्ल्या मनशाचें मडेंच मेळना. मेळना म्हणजे सकयल न्हंयेंतल्या उदकांत बुकेल्लें नुस्तें आसा, हाडां लेगीत ना करता. इतली लक्तुबाय करून वाडयलो हो देह नुस्त्याच्या तोंडांत दिवप? हांगा उपाशी देह सुण्याचे भकीक घालचे परस मेल्या उपरांत नुस्त्याच्या तोंडांत दिल्यार कितें वायट? आनी देहाक विटिल्ल्या मनशान, हांव ह्या संवसाराक विटलां, अर्थ एकूच. ह्या संवसारांत तुज्या देहाक सुवात ना, मागीर त्या देहाचे मेल्या उपरांत कितें जातली हाची चिंता कित्याक? त्या महाकवीची गजाल तुका सांगता. ताणें जिवतभर नुस्त्याचो मोग केलो, निमाणें मरतना लेगीत नुस्त्याचो कांटो गळ्यांत आडखळिल्ल्यान मेलो. ताज्या मृत्यूपत्रा प्रमाण ताजे मडे न्हंयत नुस्त्याची बकीक घाले. हे तो व्हड विचार. जाज्या मासार आपली कूड पोसली तीच कूड अखेर तांकांच ओंपली. आनी अजाप वेळार त्या न्हंयेंतले जाणी जाणी नुस्तें खालें ते कवी जाले. त्या प्रसिद्ध कवीचें नांव कितें? कवीच्या जिवितांतल्यो फक्त असल्योच घटना मतींत दवरपाच्यो आसतात, तांची नांवां आनी कविता न्ही. तूं कितें तरी कल्पने भायले सांगूंक सोदता. देखूनच तर इतले पयस सावन लोक हांगा येतात. पेपरांतले तुजे जायरातीचो अर्थ कितें? तुवें जायरात सारकी वाचिल्ली दिसना, बेसवरी वाचल्या. तुमकां जीव दीन दिसतात, आमकां मेळात. मागीर म्हाका दिसलें तूं जीव दिवंक सोदतल्यान कसलो तरी मार्ग दाखयतलो. तुका आदींच सांगलां म्हजो धंदो उक्तो, सामको उक्तो. तुज्या धंद्याक लायसन आसा? लायसन नाशिल्ले अशे कितले धंदे चलता. कायद्यान आत्महत्या करप हो गुन्यांव हें तुका खबर ना? आत्महत्या करतना वाचलो जाल्यार गुन्यांव, मेलो जाल्यार मुक्ती. तुजेर खुनाचो आळो येवचो ना कसो? पुलिसांक कळ्यात, पूण पुलिसांना पावतलेच कशें? इतले पयस येवन खुनाचे धागे दोरे उस्तुपाक पुलिसांक घर दार संवसार आसा काय ना म्हूण समजलो तूं? आनी वचत थंय संप मोर्चा हरताळ चलतना पुलिसांक हांगा आडवटेन येवपाची गरजूच कितें? आनी आयलेच जाल्यार बॉल्स घट करून वतले. तांकां तरी नितीचो पासो कित्याक बाजचो? हय, ते म्हज्या दोळ्यांनी देखला हांवें, अणभव आसा मरे. मागीर असो कूळ खबर आसून खूळ कित्याक पांगुडता? आनी म्हाका एक सांग, आत्महत्या हो गुन्यांव हें कोणें थारायलें? तांकां केन्ना आत्महत्येची गरज भाशिल्ली? जीव दिवपाचें म्हत्व पटिल्लें? समजुया, त्या कायदे पंडितांच्या जाग्यार तूं आशिल्लो जाल्यार कसो निर्णय घेतलो आशिल्लो? हांव आत्महत्येक चडांत चड उत्तेजन दितलो आसलो. म्हणटकच जीव दिवप गुन्यांव हो कायदो काळा भायर जालो ना? ह्या संवसारांत जल्माक येवपूय गुन्यांव आनी मरवपूय गुन्यांव. आतां फाटले उगडास काडून जिवितांत अशांती निर्माण करूं नाका, मन नितळ कर. आतां तूं एका नव्या संवसारांत पावल दवरपाक मुखार सरला. ना, ह्या कट्यावयल्यान जीव दिवपाक म्हज्यान जावचें ना. पिसो हो सादो कटो न्ही, नव्या संवसाराचें प्रवेशवार. माथ्या वयलें उक्तें मळप तुका निमाणो आशिर्वाद दितलें. न्हंयेचे देगेवयली झाडां तुका खांदयो हालोवन निमाणो निरोप दितली. झाडां वयली सुकणीं तुजे खातीर निमाणी प्रार्थना म्हणटली. आनी सकयली खळखळटी निळी न्हंय संवसारांत तुज्या आवयन तुका घेतलो नात तितल्या मोगान तुका अचळय गोपांत घेतली. थँक्यू.
Regret having to intervene, but the inevitable brings me here. Driven to desperation, the purveyor points out to the young man, the desperate man, the only way is to jump over the cliff of embankment. And there is an argument deftly woven with very gentle tinges of humor. It talks about the need and the compulsion to die and the urge to stay alive. And at the end of this little argument, there is a case made for committing suicide. And what is that? People who speak against suicide, who have made the laws, have they ever been driven to suicide? Has it been their need? And then therefore, it is in any way an obsolete decision, he says. And finally, he tries to convince him, why don't you simply jump over? Why do you think of afterlife when your body is vital only as long as you're alive? And so he says, what if I jump over? What will happen to it? And he says, there are fishes waiting there. to make a meal of you. And he also draws his attention to that beautiful episode of a great poet who was fed on fish and whose last wish was that his remains should be fed to them in turn. So this man says, that is an unthinkable idea to me. And he says, why? When the treetops are waiting to shower their blessings on you, when the chirping birds are singing the last goodbyes to you, and the lagoon-like calm waters are waiting to hold you in a maternal embrace, why should you hesitate? And so the young man decides to take the plunge, and let us see what happens.
Thank you, Devu Bhare Guru.
Just want to say, I have to say, since Pundalik Bab chose not to read the end, I have to tell you because I can't leave you in this kind of a lurch. There are two other people who come. They're desperate and they say, I want to die. Please help me die. And the man says, no, there is someone here who has a preference. I have to deal with him first. And there is a scuffle. And finally, this man decides that he's going to take the plunge. And he does. And those two, when they see his plight jumping over the cliff, they just decide that this is not the option for them, and they scamper away. And in a while, we can see our man drenched, trembling with cold, but still back. And he tells the purveyor, you have shown me the path to life. After having struggled through the waters and survived the tug and pull of the waves, I know how I can conquer life. And here, Marnkato becomes the embankment of not death, but life. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
What an extraordinary play. And now we've got to add Pundalik as an actor to his other achievements. Now, we had some difficulty with getting one of our Goa writers up on stage. Salil is a poet, and he will be reading some Goan poems in a few minutes. But I'm so glad to have him here, and he's really one of the outstanding members of the Goa writers group. Now, it is time for me to ask Maria Aurora to read, but before that, I've got to confess why this is not a very good day for me. Some years ago, she wrote a marvelous book, Goa, A Daughter's Story. I wish I had written that book. I would have called it A Son's Story. But in any case, she wrote a better book than I could ever have. And now she has become a fiction writer.
No.
All right, then, so explain to me what your new book is about.
I'll explain at the mic.
You will explain at the mic. All right.
That's fine.
So, Aurora, please.
Yes.
Good evening, friends. Before I start, I'd like to thank our governor, Sri Vanchu, for creating this absolutely magical evening. I have been, in many ways, on and off, inside and outside these gardens, this Raj Bhavan, this chapel, this everything since 1962. So this is a very deeply emotional moment for me. And if I hesitate and I stumble, you must forgive me. It is not a fiction book. I had an old student of mine who is now 50 who was staying with me last week, and she said, why don't you call it biofiction? I have often been told by my friends that mine is the last generation that is aware of a certain culture that is dying or is dead, perhaps. And I am very lucky to have lived both inside and outside Goa, and inside Goa very closely. And I have not lost my languages, neither Konkani nor Portuguese. And I've really been pushed into not Goa Daughter Story, that is something I did, but more or less pushed into writing this book, because it's been sort of waiting to be written for the last 30 years. So if that book was a macrocosm, this, I would say, is a microcosm. and it is called Philomena's Journeys, a portrait of a marriage, a family, and a culture. And Philomena is my mother. The book is a third-person narrative of a complicated relationship in complex times. It spans early 20th century until 1945, then Dharwar in Karnataka, and later it is set in post-1961 Goa. It touches upon the blurring and audacious defiance of political, social, and structural boundaries such as landowner and munkar, independent India and Goa as a Portuguese colony, village and town, urban landed elite and rural proprietors. These form the larger portrait that frames the intimate relationships occurring within a family. The first passage describes elements of Philomena's ancestral village, Raya, where she grew up. Early one morning, Aurora walks along the paths that Philomena used to tread daily for mass. Her urban self is stilled by a vision of expansive field. The distant whiteness of seminary and church lies half concealed in the deep green of rural Goa. While Raya stretches along the left bank of the river Zuari, Siroda, the village to which Philomena became intimately connected after her marriage, lies on the opposite northern bank. Sheikh's family owned land there. When she stood on this side of the river, fishing, praying, and playing with her friends, did she have a sense that the two banks would one day become inseparable in her consciousness? That both sides of the river would be one in her mind and soul? Philomena may have been aware of the history of these villages only in a subliminal way, as a woman who found strength in female deities, Santa Philomena, Santa Teresina, the Blessed Virgin in her various forms, in Lourdes, in Fatima, Our Lady of Snows, Nossa Senhora de Piedad. Did she in her subconscious self feel the strength of Kamakshi, the goddess of ancient times who had presided over Raya? The history of the two villages, Raya and Siroda, separates and unites them through the flight of Kamakshi from Raya when pursued by Portuguese religious authorities and her safe landing in Siroda, which was not yet Portuguese territory. When the temple of Kamakshi was destroyed by the captain of Rashol, Diogo Rodrigues, the image of the deity Kamakshi was smuggled across the river by a potter who carried the idol across to the other shore. The potter community since then has been given the principal right to burn the first lamp at the main festival. Kamakshi, the goddess, found a new home. Yet for the converts, the power of the goddess myth was then invested in the Virgin Mary, Nossa Senhora, Sibin Mai. In the agricultural community, particularly among the tribal communities, Gaurai and Kunbi, Mother Earth was worshipped as mother of all creation. She gave birth to what nourished. She was the core of life, the core of strength, expressed in the worship of the mother goddess. Women who worked the earth found self-reliance. Mother Earth and Mother Goddess protected and appears to have inculcated an inbuilt self-sustaining strength, the kind of strength characteristic of Philomena all her life. The next passage takes place in the last section of the book and describes the death of Philomena's husband. Sheikh's body was laid out in the chapel of the hospital in Margao. Philomena was too dazed to focus on anything. She held on to her daughter. Tears had flowed all through the night at home, and then as the taxi sped across Ghats to reach the frontier at dawn. She now sat stunned, dry-eyed. They were left alone to grieve and pray quietly before the mourners arrived in time for the funeral at 4 o'clock. A large group of relatives and friends had traveled distances crossing ferries. They gazed at the calm face, a look of peace on features that were etched more sharply in death, hair much grayer than Aurora remembered, although she had seen him only a month earlier. His suit concealed the shrunken body. All signs of despair and fury, neglect and excess, replaced by the icy calmness of death. His fingers were clasped round a rosary. Fingers she could see flying on piano keys, while the body, now stiff, once used to sway to the tune he hummed. His vitality had already seeped out when she last saw him, drained by loneliness and desolation, seeped by delusions. Isolated, perhaps shunned by his peer group, he had found solace among a few relatives and with the divine, his rosary always in his hand or in his pocket. She was unable to let go of the image of this figure, his fleet-footed walk, his stillness on the stool while he played quietly to himself, the slight nod to the choir when the voices synchronized perfectly. Mourners filed around the coffin. Many of them were Sheikh's peer group, music lovers, some of them Margaon gallants once upon a time, perhaps brooding over memories of their own lost youth, perhaps overwhelmed at the sight of the distraught widow and awareness of 7 fatherless children. Information regarding the family may have been whispered around while they stood outside. Except for a few relatives, no one present would have known of their life in Darwar. They would have been surprised to see Sheikh's daughter in a sari. And the last passage is set 6 months after liberation, when the civilian government replaced military rule, and recounts the arrival of Philomena's son-in-law in Goa. I selected this passage because I think it's so apposite, it's almost extraordinary that I should be reading this passage here, because the son-in-law was the secretary to the first Lieutenant Governor of Goa after liberation. So this office of the Lieutenant Governor was integral to the son-in-law's early professional life. Philomena's eldest daughter's marriage changed the life of the family in many ways. Precisely 6 months to a day after they were married, the liberation of Goa in December 1961 and the appointment of Alban a few months later as secretary to the first Lieutenant Governor of Goa and then as Goa's first development commissioner moved the focus of Philomena's family back to Goa. The liberation of Goa brought in its wake social mobility for many. For Philomena, it was a paradoxical example of tragedy followed by a happy ending. The Satyagraha movement, which had led to the closing of the borders, had provoked Sheikh's flight to Goa never to return, in fact, to his death. For her, this was a tragic personal circumstance aggravated by historical inevitability. That this same history should then be responsible for the arrival of a son-in-law in a prominent position in the new administration was a sort of reversal of fortune. Philomena understood nothing of the wider implications or indeed the politics of colonialism, freedom struggles, and liberation. Most women of her generation lived in a closed world dedicated to supervision of land and devotion to God and family, unless their husbands were part of the ruling establishment, in which case, apart from devotion to God and family, there was a wider social life. Darwar and her own traumas had protected her from knowledge of experience of the worst excesses of the Salazar regime. She knew that liberation had cleared all these major problems. It had also brought her son-in-law to Goa, and all this had been achieved after much struggle and sacrifice by many. Yet this struggle had entailed the closing of borders, and that had precipitated in her mind the death of her husband. The whole thing was a confusion of events. The personal dominated, the political, the public was not something that impinged on her consciousness. It happened. It had to happen. It must be a good thing. When the armed intervention took place, she worried about her family in Goa. Were they safe? No letters, no news. Goan students in Darwar gave snippets of reassuring information. Their own travel up and down, their very survival was affected during those years, when borders were closed and there was the ban on transfer or carrying of money across the border. Philomena also knew of confusion and concern in Margaon, where her friends and relatives lived, many of whom were officers in the erstwhile Portuguese administration. This generation, whether employed or needing to attend to personal matters that needed official endorsements, lived with uncertainty. There were trips to be made to the revenue office to pay tax on land or other matters. Officers known as deputationists from neighboring states had yet to familiarize themselves with existing norms, and Goans had to familiarize themselves with a new language, English. a trip to any of the government offices was not reassuring. Conversation and discussion heightened the tension. Newspapers, which had been crushed by decades of censorship, embraced their freedom to write with unbridled passion, critical of the new regime, the absence of a sense of direction, ambiguity about the future, rapid changes, the imposition of English, the end of Bhatkar Raj, the muscle flexing of the Munkar class, who sensed an end to their patient wait for justice. VIPs arrived in a whirlwind from Delhi, bearing reassurances, promises, and plans. Although Philomena had heard that the Catholic community felt threatened, she was immeasurably secure herself. She had made a life in Darwar, where Catholics were a minuscule minority. Yet she sensed that for most Catholics in Goa after liberation, religion and language, which had earlier given security, were now powerless. Even conversing in Portuguese, the main language of communication among the middle classes, was suspect. She did not grapple with the intricacies of political change, but she knew instinctively that Alban would cope. After all, she was praying, his mother Ansi was praying. Alban's work was at many levels: practical, social, conceptual, diplomatic, building trust, while setting up a system that worked for Goa within the new dispensation. He often praised the Goan officers who had been part of the Portuguese administration, but for whom, he said, the transition could not have been effected smoothly. His first priority was to listen and learn, then adjust and adapt, so that change could be gradual and effective. He reassured Philomena, who talked to him sometimes about the general feeling, fears of change, which she did not understand, since her own life had been one of dramatic change and upheaval. Yet she sympathized and she listened, but was careful not to allow herself to be used by many who sought her out as a way to get to her son-in-law. She was grateful to be away in Darwar, out of reach. Thank you.
It is now my pleasure to call on a Goan poet who has transplanted himself successfully in our midst and has been welcomed here. Is indistinguishable from a son of the soil, because he is now a son of the soil. Manohar Shetty, a friend for many years, and his fifth volume of poetry will be launched today. Manohar?
There's no one to officially launch it, so here it is.
Oh, am I to launch it? Are you ready? It will take me, but that's how his poetry functions. I have read part of it and I loved it. Now it's for you to enjoy.
I've lived in Goa for almost 30 years, but it took me almost 10 years before I could actually write poems about Goa. The first one I wrote was, Goa didn't get enough under my skin for me to write about the place. The first one I wrote was about maybe 10 years ago. It's called Stills from Baga Beach. Vast freckled English women, pylon limbed, thaw in the sun. Their breasts loll out like baby sea lions. Flabby leftovers of Valhalla, diet on bread and bananas. Their dozing blue eyes stroke small boys in torn pajamas. The German studies the Vedanta in translation through Chromax dark glasses. Her oozing tattoo mopped by blue bottles. The temple elephant, vermilion swastika on its domed forehead, lumbers unblinking over the buff sands. Second poem is called Taverna. After 20 years of yoga, and mastery of its acrobatic asanas. Forehead on the floor, feet round the neck, total breath control. He tripped over the doormat and died of cardiac arrest. All of 44. Clean living, as he put it once, is the path to nirvana. At the Good Luck Taverna, Eddie, 74, pours three quarters of Caju Fenny, topped by a shot of Dottor's brandy, down the hatch below a picture of Mother Mary, between sunset till the bar shuts at 12. He goes home on his moped without troubling the potholes or the pigs, and sleeps the sleep of the just. This is ritual the past 40 years, though every Christmas, Doc warns him it's his last. I asked him once over a peg, boiled eggs, and a saucer of peanuts, the secret of his long life and sound health. He blinked behind his soda water bottle lenses and said, "Drink, siesta, and God bless. What for you is poison is for me tonic and medicine." This is also a poem about Goa, but could be of any provincial place. Local. Here the minnow is king, and the king is shark. The goldfish is queen in a dome of glass. Here a rumor is news, spiked with hard proof. Here the local bully is the head constable, and the pickpocket a highway bandit. The shy neighbor with a sty is a red-eyed alcoholic. And the tourist with telephoto lenses is a spy. And roadside Romeos and jaywalkers should be sentenced to life. Here a snide remark made 9 years ago is a slur against family honor. And no uncle, fast friend or jury can avenge the blasphemy. Here the bell of the ball is the next Miss Universe. And the priest of corner shrine and chapel, the pontiff. This poem also about Goa. These poems came in a sudden rush about, and as I said, it took me a very long time to get under the skin of this place. This is for all my Gulf returned friends. It's called Dinars. Dinars. His house stands tall over the rest, boundary walls orange as the sunset, topped with jagged glass. The gates are parrot green, an SUV purrs in his garage. At Sunday church, the wife in shimmering pink flashes the thick gold ring, and on her sand dune bosom, a chunky necklace to match his. They kneel in the front pew with their four kids in checked suits and rosy frocks. Their voices roar over the choir like a sandstorm. On his 50th birthday, his cake was domed like a sheikh's palace. The champagne flowed like oil, and he swore as their son from the village. And with the blessings of his parish priest, to the cause of a new Goa, to ushering in the winds of change, to taking power back to the people. This is a very new poem. It is dedicated to all reformed drunkards. It's a serious poem. 10 feet tall. In my drinking days, I never slept, only passed out, and woke up my eyes red as Mars. Amnesiac, my head a rattling alarm clock, amnesiac to the past 20 hours when my tongue ran away with itself. I know how it felt to feel 10 feet tall, lurching about like a leaning, beaming tower of Pisa. Now sober, I remain mostly quiet, content with the lime and soda, a humble penitent not given to garrulous argument or loss of temper, or making bosom chums with my local fisherman and barber, or tipping the waiter half my wages. In fact, I have become somewhat timid, diffident, a little remote, even reclusive, certainly not the high spirit of the party, inviting the cop on duty for a nip or two into the speakeasy with a gangster's swagger. But unlike the phantom with his wolf, I haven't switched to a glass of milk at the bar counter. In times of extreme tension, I keep my patience and don't attack the bottle with that resultant loss of dignified balance, or fully dressed, drop half dead under a running shower in my bathtub. The doorbell ringing at milkman dawn, like church or temple bells in a storm. No, I don't cringe from that same old taunt, "Ye sala Manu ban gaya beuda." Manu is my nickname. I know how it felt to feel 10 feet tall and to wake up crunched into a doll, my head unscrewed from my neck, my fingers digging and clawing myself out from a ditch 10 feet tall. Just two more poems, slightly more serious poems. Parting note. What was once so precious, you give away with only a fleeting sense of regret. An unread classic, a designer pen set, a cut glass ashtray, or even a birthday present barely opened. You part with them one by one. You give them away to family, friends, a lucky acquaintance. They are only objects, keepsakes you no longer wish to keep for their own sake. I'll end with the last two poems on creativity itself, on what goes into making a poem. First is called Born Still. You will only be heard when the noise has died down and the air so clear you can hear the soundless soundtrack of bats, the cutting edge in a swaying blade of grass, the memoirs of elephants, the beat of a moth's wing in a distant whirlwind, the snap of a lizard's tongue, and the gossip of ants in the kitchen. It's the last poem, Make Believe. Only if you believe in make believe will water turn into wine, the wizard spin gold from a molten urn, the rains green the shrouded white desert, the looming hurricane unwind into a cool wind. Only then will the wingless bird glide over the horizon, the tiger reclaim its lost stripes, the deer its musk, the elephant its tusk, the bear its warm pelt. Only then will words rise again in your daily bread. Thank you.
Well, has Manohar launched his book? You needed no help. You needed no help from me to launch your book. We loved it. Now, may I ask, since we are running out of time now, I'll ask Salil to read a few of his poems.
I can use a cliche without any fear because it really feels an honor to be here amongst this crowd of talented people. And I'm nervous, so I've forgotten. I've been here in Goa for an year. We moved bag and baggage, familiar story. I'll begin by reading the first poem I wrote here, which is in Hindi. Ab mitti nahi hai lal, ab mitti nahi hai lal, khurduri, kankri, kirkiri, zuban par sondhi, thodi meethi, badami. दूसरी बार चखने को जी जाता है कपड़ों पर एक धूमिल याद सी हाथों पर हल्की लाल मुस्कान महक बस वही जिसे हम कभी कभी किताबों के पन्नों में ढूंढते हैं सुगंध कहानियों की और उसमें गुथे करोड़ों बारिश की बूंदें पत्ते पत्थर पहाड़ और एक मौन महान जैसे किसी गूंज गंभीर के गर्भ में गिरी शून्य कविता शून्य कविता शून्य कविता दिस ईयर वाज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर मी पर्सनली आवर चीफ मिनिस्टर हैज अनाउंस्ड दैट ही वांट्स एनिमल्स इन गोवा द फर्स्ट स्टेट टू हैव एनिमल्स इन गोवा टू हैव राइट्स एंड वाओ फैसिनेटिंग And there's been a lot of talk on that on some of the group, the Wild Goa group. And but I'm here, the rest of my poems, which I've written in Goa, I'm here representing trees. I'll start at the beginning by remembering my ancestors. Distant points of light, so light, drifting in megaparsecs, stretching wave-like, illuminating particles, illustrious buzzing electrons, they are not. My ancestors have rejected the vast darkness of space, its limitless possibilities, its curve, its bent, its infinite fields of emptiness, stars scattered like seeds, its near nothingness, its buoyancy that floats planets, not to speak of galaxies, suspended in its lymph. They have rejected its silence that swallows exploding stars as if nothing had happened. My ancestors have refused their place in the firmament and chosen to be trees, digging in their roots, spreading their filament fingers in the meshed darkness, grabbing hillsides, finding footholds on foothills of old fold mountains, feeling the rain, guiding it through their gracious drip lines, a drop at a time, letting the water into the neural networks of Prithvi, forging partnerships with mycorrhizae, playing footsie with other ancestors in the secret hallways of Gaia. My ancestors have embraced the tiny grains of soil, the swirls and eddies of mutating wildernesses, the slow walk of trees, the fungal lattice under the forest, spreading for hundreds of moist, dark miles, making it impossible to distinguish one ancestor from another. My ancestors have taken green responsibilities, the 10,000-leafed munching of light, the radical enlightenment of Buddhas, the tracing of our ductile futures. My ancestors have settled for unbroken views from ridges, for the howls of Tufan, the father of wind, for breathing canopies, healing forests, the superior knowledge, the world wisdom of wood. So I don't do to trees what I won't do to mothers. I don't know, whenever I think of the Western Ghats, I think Ma. She's lying down in a long stretch down the western coast. This one's called Ever is Before the Silent Tree. They're all tree poems. In its growth messy, at the alone north corner of a two-story building, advertising the slight breeze and reap eating its mantras, don't get caught up in that God thing. Offering processed sunlight in tiny cream cups to 40 about fat bumblebees. The birds watch this clever ploy, this naked sacred ritual. They sit on the pregnant tree's branches, singing songs of birthing, calling forth the fruit, while the tree advertises the breeze and reap eats. But this time the mantra is different. Whatever you will study, you will destroy. And as the bumblebees tip the tiny cups, hanging upside down, quite full, this, around here, the best way to say thank you is to be happy. The birds call out, the tree reap eats, and still, ever is before this silent tree. I think I'll skip because of time. Of course, then there were the monsoons that gave me the luxury to stop and see things. This one's called Small Stopping and Seeing. I've been watching the mulling of this land, its grass notions, its wild yam concepts, uncultivated football lily ideas, its vine hypothesis. It's amazing what happens to gold when it rains. Its butterfly flashes, mushrooming postulations, its confident moss opinions. And I've been thinking, how did I drift away from it all? With my broken wing and hobbled flight. But I've seen birds transform into clouds in a certain light. Okay, two more. I live on Shirao Island, and the only way to get there is by ferry. I am proud to say that I am the only one in this last year who has seen otters in the Mandovi River on the island. That's because I spend a lot of my time doing nothing, just under trees and near the river. This one's called Evening by the Mandovi. I must accept the sun's rays on the water, the dogs playing in the tall grass fields, the old man sitting with a stick by the river, the cuckoo calling from the mangroves, and the pollen-laden bumblebees hanging from wild golden flowers. I must accept the call of the fishing eagle, the clouds reflecting the evening sun, my skin slowly turning the color of fire, and the long line of white ibis wafting in the sky as smoke. I must accept that there is something going on in her life. In the dead of night, she sweeps dried leaves and sets them on fire. I must accept the pleasures of people, abandoned stone quarries, broken bottles, that you are trying to rob me of my essences, my placid anger. I must accept that it is the night of demons. In the morning, they'll all be gone. Once we get past the inadequacy of language, aren't we all heroes? This is my last one. I look at a tree and I find it taller. I look at a tree and I find it taller than any man I've ever met or heard or told or read about. In its stance, I find more meaning than in any word or phrase I've ever uttered. In its branches, I see all philosophies pecked at, eaten, and dropped back to the soil as nutrients for nematodes. I look at a tree stand in the harshest of suns, and I admire that stand more than I have admired anyone else's stand. I sit in its white shadows and see its canopy cover all arguments, with space to spare for some sparring sparrows. I look at a tree and how I wish for squirrels to run up my back, for owls to sleep in my armpits, and for a hard lignin to cover my ears and my eyes, and for my hands to fall upwards where starlight beckons. Thank you.
Salil, a much loved, a much loved member of the Goa Writers Group. We are coming to the end of our session here, but I have an announcement to make. You know, Ravi Shankar passed away a couple of days ago, and now later, Harshada, a very celebrated artist, very vivacious and very mischievous in some ways, I call her, she will be producing some artwork here spontaneously in as a tribute to the memory of Ravi Shankar. Now it is my pleasure to call on yet another poet. Wait. Oh, look at this. I have to get everything right. Maman Dal, an award-winning poet from Arunachal Pradesh. Won't you?
Thank you, Victor. His Excellency, Sri Bharat Veer Wanchu, Governor of Goa, First Lady, Madam Wanchu, dear friends, thank you very much for giving us this wonderful venue and this wonderful occasion. I will read three poems. They are from a collection called Midsummer Survival Lyrics, and they have it's a new unpublished collection, and they've just appeared in some journals and in a translation project with the University of Cordoba. One is The Poet and His Song. This summer, I can sing the songs of the caged warrior, singing to the rough anonymity of the tree. And here on these branches, leaf, bark, I can leave the shell of my armor like the shells of forgotten words, recalling everything we once knew. Time, what is it? It is the symbol of a man who loved cloud and mist, distributing songs. Time, what does it matter? We made flowers and sunlight and bracelets of rain, distributing songs. Now I can sing the bright crackling words in the memory of songs, begging the forgiveness of butterflies and beauty that we destroyed in our hunt for life. This summer, time slanting across the land, time will tell what it means, loving from a distance. Second poem, The Sorrow of Women. They are talking about hunger. They are saying there is an unquenchable fire burning in our hearts. My love, what shall I do? I am thinking how I may lose you to war and big issues more important than me. Life is so hard like this. Nobody knows why. It is like fire. It is like rainwater, sand, glass. What shall I do, my love, if my reflection disappears? They are talking about a place where rice flows on the streets, about a place where there is gold in the leaves of trees. They are talking about displacement, when the opium poppy was growing, dizzy in the sun, happy in a state of believing. And they are talking about escape, about liberty, men and guns. Ah, the urgency for survival. But what will they do, not knowing the sorrow of women? My last poem. This was actually written when I was, or the inspiration for this came when I was interviewing an old man in one of our villages. We were sitting on a high hill and the river was below. It was a program for Itanagar Doordarshan. And he said, you know, oh, from here I can see Dibrugarh, I can see Assam, I can see Tirap, I can see Nagaland, which he couldn't actually, but it was like he could see the whole world, you know. And this image stayed with me. He put on the red coat that in British days used to be treasured for, as a mark of, you know, a political interpreter. And I had my little umbrella and we were doing this interview. So that became the origin of the title of my book. It became the title of a chapter. It became the title of a poem. And finally, it's come out as The Voice of the Mountain. From where I sit on the high platform, I can see the ferry lights crossing, crisscrossing the big river. I know the towns, the estuary mouth. There beyond the last bank where the color drains from heaven, I can outline the chapters of the world. The other day, a young man arrived from the village. Because he could not speak, he brought a gift of fish from the land of rivers. It seems such acts are repeated. We live in territories forever ancient and new, and as we speak in changing languages, I also leave my spear leaning by the tree and try to make a sign. I am an old man sipping the breeze that is forever young. In my life, I have lived many lives. My voice is sea waves and mountain peaks. In the transfer of symbols, I am the chance syllable that orders the world, instructed with history and miracles. I am the desert and the rain, the wild bird that sits in the west, the past that recreates itself and particles of life that clutch and cling for thousands of years. I know these things as rocks know, burning in the sun's embrace, about clouds and sudden rain. As I know, a cloud is a cloud is a cloud. A cloud is this uncertain pulse that sits over my heart. In the end, the universe yields nothing except a dream of permanence. Peace is a falsity. A moment of rest comes after long combat. From the east, the warrior returns with the blood of peonies. I am the child who died at the edge of the world, the distance between end and hope, the star diagram that fell from the sky, the summer that makes men weep, and the lost stories of women who survive with happiness to carry on. I am the breath that opens the mouth of the canyon, the sunlight on the tips of trees. There where the narrow gorge hastens the wind, I am the place where memory escapes the myth of time. I am the sleep in the mind of the mountain. Thank you. Then I'll read this one. This is called Small Towns and the River. It's about my hometown. This was written actually in mourning for an aunt who died young. She died in Delhi, so they had to bring her home, you know, on the ferry. And my uncle was, I think because of the loss, he was pretending, and even when, you know, everything was happening, he was combing his hair and looking in the mirror and not talking to people. Small towns and the river. Small towns always remind me of death. My hometown lies calmly amidst the trees. It is always the same in the summer or winter, with the dust flying or the wind howling down the gorge. Just the other day, someone died. In the dreadful silence, we wept, looking at the sad wreath of tuberose. Life and death, life and death. Only the rituals are permanent. The river has a soul, In the summer, it cuts through the land like a torrent of grief. Sometimes I think it holds its breath, seeking the land of fish and stars. The river has a soul. It knows, stretching past the town, from the first drop of rain to dry earth and mist on the mountain tops, the river knows the immortality of water. A shrine of happy pictures marks the days of childhood. Small towns grow with anxiety for future generations. The dead are placed pointing west. When the soul rises, it will walk into the golden east, into the house of the sun. In the cool bamboo, restored in the sunlight, life matters like this. In small towns by the river, we all want to walk with the gods. Thank you.
What an absolute feast. I've seldom been so moved by such a wealth of literary talent as we have heard in just one evening here. Now, may I call on my last guest, Jeet, Thayil. Jeet lived in Manhattan, a few miles from where I was in the United States, but we had to come to Goa to meet here. We also had lunch at Ukokero. He sat at one end of the dining room, I sat at the other. I looked at him, he looked at me, and we didn't think that we should talk to each other. Now we will talk.
I looked across the room and I saw this gentleman sitting and eating lunch alone as I was, and I thought, that's what I want to do one day.
It's all kinds.
Hi, it's a pleasure to be here. Unexpected pleasure because, you know, I'm a poet and I wrote a novel called Narcopolis, and I never expected to be invited to Raj Bhavan, you know. In fact, every time I see the friendly policeman, I'm expecting to be politely escorted out. Anyway, it is genuinely a pleasure to be here with friends, and unlike most people on the dais today, I'm not from Goa. I wish I was. Wish I lived here. I live in Delhi. You know, Delhi, Goa. I have no idea why, but that's the way it is. And every time I come to Goa, I was thinking, I have the Goa fantasy that Delhiites have, which is to one day move here. So I'm going to start with a poem about Goa. I spent a lot of New Year's in Goa in the 90s, as many people do, and often found myself on nameless beaches at midnight. And of course, inevitably the next morning I would be overcome by remorse, regret, self-loathing, all those things that you become friends with, you know, when you kind of find yourself on a beach at midnight, New Year's. This is called New Year Goa. The midnight's cataracts whiten, and here's the sea hissing its one stuttered consonant. Leaf printed, you track the moon to a beached, bearded hull, a room of vertigo or freedom that narrows like memory. Small flames ascend a tree of light. The 32 palaces of Bodhisattvam tremble on the vellum smooth water like flotsam. If tonight the mind is queasy, drawing thoughts like flies, he is fine too with every crazy scheme you devise, none crazier than this pilgrimage to a pier that seems to have disappeared, leaving you seaborn at last, ahead of you the past and all its famous cities lost. Yeah. This is the city of insomnia. There's a parade in the white streets of the city. All night, the armored cars trundle past the avenue. Dazed men and women stand, making circles with their hands, their smudged eyes wide open. At dawn, the silent mayor arrives, climbs the stairs to your room, takes a moment to catch his breath, and presents you with a key you will wear around your neck like a star. These next few poems aren't poems, really. They're entries from a kind of a self-help manual, a do-it-yourself guide kind of thing. How to be a toad. Take 3 fresh spores with a dram of rum. Hold it on your tongue for longish moments. Pack all thoughts of gold in a small leather case the size of a sapphire. Tell yourself repeatedly, I will never again be beautiful. How to be a leaf, to go with your trees. Hold your breath until you are God's green thoughts. Stop eating. Stop eating. The air will suffice for food. Water is another matter. The skin absorbs nutrients, eyes adjust, limbs grow inward. Conjugate patience, worship women and trees. That's a feminist one. How to be a horse. Know the nostril, all power gathers there. Inflate yours until the blood rings. It will take all your training to be horse, not ass. This is a thin crossing, perilous to the absent-minded and the estranged of heart. Avoid all latitudes. How to be a bandicoot. And if you don't know what a bandicoot is, it's a very large Bombay rat. No, I'm not making this up, it's true. They're virtually unkillable. They can't be poisoned because they become immune to rat poison. They can't be drowned because they swim very well. If you drop them off a tall building, they'll probably bounce. The only way to get rid of them is probably to shoot them. How to be a bandicoot. Assume dominance over the underworld. Your enemies are legion. Eat them. Eat everything. You must build your strength. A crash will surely come. Your eyes are red legends. Your name is Adam. Thank you. How to be a crow. Learn to name the animals one by one. Stinking, babbling, breedy, querulous, maddened, jet. Usurp the duties of God. Why not? After all, this is what poets do. As for crow, kill color, turn black, not nigger, black. Thank you. Next thing I have for you is a ghazal. Which is a series of couplets, usually discrete couplets, as long as you want or as short as you want, and they always end, there's some conventions, they end with a refrain and a rhyme. And the refrain in this case is in Malayalam, and the rhyme is air. So the rhyme changes in each couplet, but it always ends with in Malayalam, which is the challenge of writing a ghazal. And the last couplet has to mention the poet has to mention his own name in the last ghazal, which of course, you know, poets love to do, right? Put their own name into a ghazal. This is Malayalam's ghazal. Listen, someone's saying a prayer in Malayalam. He says, there's no word for despair in Malayalam. At night, you sing a Gujarati garba. At daybreak, you open your hair in Malayalam. To understand symmetry, understand Kerala. The longest palindrome is there in Malayalam. Visitors are welcome to the School of Lost Tongues. Someone's endowed a high chair in Malayalam. I greet you, my ancestors, O scholars and linguists, my father who recites Baudelaire in Malayalam. When you've been too long in the rooms of English, open the windows to the fresh air of Malayalam. Jeet, such drama with the scraps you know. Write a couplet, if you dare, in Malayalam. This is reaffirmations from the sky above us. This is a kind of a reply to Manohar's fantastic alcohol poem. This is dedicated to a poet I hold single-handedly responsible for many wasted young poets' lives. You know, poets have this idea that you burn your life at both ends like a candle, you drink too much, you do every substance that comes your way, you fall in love with the wrong people, and you die young. That's the romantic idea. And a lot of us actually try and do that, you know. Only problem is, while you're living that life, you don't get much writing done. This poem is addressed to the poet I hold responsible for many wasted years of my own life, to Baudelaire. I am over you at last, in Mexico City, in a white space high above the street, my hands steady, the walls unmoving. It's warm here and safe, and even in winter, the rain is benign. Some mornings, I let the sounds of the plaza, a fruit seller, a boy acrobat, a woman selling impossible fictions, pile up in a corner of the room. I'm not saying I'm happy, but I am healthy, and my money is my own. Sometimes, when I'm walking in the market, past the chickens and the pig smoke, I think of you, your big talk and wolf's heart, your Bonaparte hair and eyes of Poe. I don't miss you. I don't miss you when I open a window and light fills the room like water pouring into a paper cup, or when I see a woman's white dress shine like new coins and I know I could follow my feet to the river and let my life go away from me. At times like this, if I catch myself talking to you, I am always surprised at the words I hear of regret and dumb, boyish devotion. Thank you very much. Thank you. Good night.
I have a question for you, Damodar. When is Harshada going to do her work?
It's already done.
Oh, it did over there?
Yeah, over there.
You mean we cheated everybody here? But we had a good time, didn't we? And for that, we have to thank you, Governor. We have to thank you and you, Mrs. Wanchu. This is such a fantastic setting here. I was taken back in time, not only to the time of Kamoj, but we have the two rivers here, which are historic rivers, though the world does not know them as such. In the time of Cleopatra and Julius Caesar, there were boats that were coming from Egypt via the Red Sea, from Africa, coming all the way up the Zuari to our ancient capitals, of course. On this side, Albuquerque sailed, and then Vasco da Gama, and finally Camões, who has now become, thanks to you, our Goan poet. By residence, as other poets have become, as you have, Manohar, and you will too.
I hope so.
Now let us all thank our governor for his...
There's a play after this.
Yes, there is a play, but will you be here for the play? Oh, you will be here for the play. So we will thank you again. A round of applause for the guests.